Thank you very much. So this is actually, this is abbreviated title of my talk, but actually more accurate than the original one. So first of all, let me make a convention right away that all groups in this talk are going to be discrete and finitely generated. So before talking about property FLP, let me introduce property, which I assume most of you have seen before. So definition. So a group G, so it's a finitely generated group generated by some finite set S, has Kazhdan's property T. If there exists an epsilon greater than zero, such that if pi v is a unitary representation of G, so V is just some Hilbert space. Which has an S epsilon invariant vector, then V actually has a non-zero invariant vector. Okay. Let's make it unit vector, since I didn't define what S epsilon invariant is. Okay, yeah, so S epsilon invariant means that when you act on that vector by any of the generators, it is moved by less than epsilon. Right, so in other words, existence of almost invariant vector is equivalent, implies the existence of an invariant vector. So for discrete groups, this property T happens to be equivalent to another property. So this is equivalent to property FH, which is stated in the language of not unitary representation, but affine isometric actions on Hilbert spaces. So affine just means representation plus a constant. So property FH, so G has property FH if any affine isometric action of G on a Hilbert space has a global fixed point. Okay. So both these properties have been studied extensively, well, properties TC since the 60s, property FH probably since the 70s. And the more recent trend is to look at the analog of these properties for Banach spaces. So if B is a Banach space, we can define analogously properties which I will denote by T sub B and F sub B. Right, so T sub B would be counterpart of P, F sub B would be the counterpart of FH. So, and then in this terminology, T is the same as TL2 and FH is the same as F, okay, I'm being inconsistent, and actually, sorry, my title is not correct, so this FLP should actually be the subscript. Okay, so now, yeah, let's make all of them subscripts. Okay, so now here I don't really need to specify which L2 I'm talking about because all separable Hilbert spaces are isomorphic to each other, and because I'm looking at finely generated groups in the, the definition of all these properties, it's enough to assume that it's enough to do it for separable Hilbert spaces. Okay, so now what is going to be FLP? So the simplest way, there are slightly different people mean slightly different things by FLP. So with my definition, the simplest way to define it would be that this is just F of the space LP 0, 1. So this is just the unit interval with Lebesgue measure. But actually, once you have this, you also have FLP X mu for any sufficiently nice measure space X mu. OK, and so similar, same thing for TLP. OK. And so first, let me state some general properties, some relation between these properties. So in my talk, I will only look at these properties for B equal to LP for some P, but they have been studying for more general spaces. Okay, so some basic connections between these properties. So first, FB always implies TB. And the interesting thing is that the converse is not true in general. Okay, so second is that property T always implies TLP, actually equivalent to TLP for P greater than 1. Three is that T also implies FLP, but this is only for P from 1 to 2. OK, and the fourth property is that T does not imply FLP in general. So properties 1 through 3 were proved in pretty much seminal paper on the subject by Uri Bader, Alex Furman, Sahi Gelander, and Nicolas Monod. And I'm going to refer to this paper several times, so I'm just going to refer to this combination as BFGM from now on. Okay, and so property 4. Okay, I guess let me use this board feature. So property 4, it's actually it's a consequence of, for example, is a consequence of a theorem of Goliang Yu, who proved that for any, if G is a hyperbolic group, any hyperbolic group, then G does not have FLP for sufficiently large P. Right, and so because FLP always implies TLP, and TLP is equivalent to T, so if this was true, that would have, and we know that they exist hyperbolic groups with property T, and so this tells you that they exist groups with property T which do not have FLP for some P, so this.
I guess you proved the properness, but it was not from a Baudin-Pajot aspect.
Yeah, well, I'm not claiming that this was the original. I'm just saying that this is one of the reasons.
Even from Ponsu. Even from Ponsu. Not vanishing of the first LP cohomology.
I think in this form it was, I'm not sure it was known before in this form, but okay, but I'm not an expert, so it's okay. Okay. Okay, so now what about positive results? So first there is a general theorem, and actually I was told that I misattributed this theorem in my abstract. So this is a result of Fisher and Margulis, which but it did appear in this paper of this four-author paper. And this says that if G has T, then there exists an epsilon greater than 0 such that G has FLP for all P in the interval from 2 to 2 plus epsilon. Right, so T does imply FLP. Well, this is a different argument, so for P from 1 to 2, and also for P sufficiently close to 2. But we don't know what happens beyond that. Unfortunately, this proof is not constructive using ultra product type of argument, so doesn't give you explicit epsilon. Okay, and there are many, okay, and so kind of a very interesting question you can ask in general is what is the structure of the set of all P such that the group has FLP? Very little known about it, and that's not a question I'm going to address in this talk. So in this talk, I'm going to discuss a method how to prove FLP for specific classes of groups where you can actually get an explicit bound on this epsilon. Okay, so kind of let's start talking about kind of positive results for. Okay, so some known positive results. Okay, so most of the results, well, pretty much all the results I'm going to mention, the way they prove for property FLP is that you take one of the methods which gives a property T for some class of groups and try to generalize the property FLP. Usually the generalizations are far from straightforward, but still kind of there are obvious similarities between the methods. So the first class of groups for which we have a pretty much complete result are lattices in higher rank. Lattices in higher rank simple algebraic groups of local fields, so local fields of any characteristic, but the simplest example would be SLNZ, n at least 3. Okay, and so for these groups, so all of these groups have T, and this was proved in most cases already in the original paper by Kazhdan. And FLP, also known for all P for these groups, and this was proved in this BFGM paper. So this is true for all P. Okay, so that's the first family. So then.
What does it be in this case?
Hmm?
For all P?
For all P, yeah. For all P.
The group have this property, each of them for all P.
Yeah, for all P, yeah. So let's call this family 1. Then the second family are the groups of the form ELNR. So by ELN, I just mean the subgroup of a GLN generated by elementary matrices. Okay, and R is a finitely generated associative ring with 1. For this group's property T, okay, so we can pretty much assume right away that N is at least 3. For N equal to 2, well, I think in all known, well, for most rings, it's known that they do not have probability, and most likely there is no single ring, well, unless the group is finite. Where it has property T. So for n greater than or equal to 3, combination of works of Shalom and Wasserstein. I mean, this was achieved in several papers. Proved this for R commutative. So this was, I think, the latest ingredient of Wetterstein preprint appeared in 2008. And then in my joint paper with Andrei Haikin, we proved this for general R. Find the generated associative ring. So first there was a proof for commutative rings. We proved it in general. But actually, shortly before this conference, Masato Mimura posted a very beautiful paper on the archive where he gives alternative proof of property for these groups. Actually, quite a simple proof. So these are different proofs. Right, so to the Masato Mimura, he's at this conference.
Actually, I put my preprint on preprint and poster session in the small room, so you can see.
Yeah, and I should mention that in both of those proofs, one of the key ingredients is Kasabov's result on relative property. Well, all of those proofs use some kind of version of relative probability, but in this case, well, relative probability is also was done by Shalom. That's why I'm not mentioning it separately. Okay, and now property FLP. In this case, everything that is known is due to Mimura. But this was achieved in two stages. So in 2011, okay, and this is also for all p, but under a separate restriction. N greater than or equal to 4. And in some sense, this restriction is not due to Mimura's proof itself, but this is due to the fact that we don't know, we don't really have a suitable analog of relative property, FLP. Okay, so in 2011 paper, he proved this for R commutative. And this was a generalization of this method. And then in this recent paper, he gave a proof for for associative, right? And this latest proof, it works virtually identically for FLP FOT. Even though if you already assume that the group has T, then you can give he can give an even easier proof, right? So all of these results are for all P. So now what about other methods? So now the third thing I want to mention is kind of a rather general method, which was introduced by Andrzej Żuk, I think the GAFA paper 2003. And roughly speaking, the method is applicable to the groups with which have presentation with lots of short relations. Well, short in a strong sense should have lots of relations of length 3. Okay, so this is a general method, so one can try to construct various examples where this method works. But the main motivation for this method was the construction of random groups with property T, and also this gave, well, that was not a new result, but a new proof of property T for the so-called A to T Lagrange. Okay, and so this method has also been extended to FLP setting in a recent paper by Piotr Novak, which just appeared in GEMS 2015. The method actually applies to these kind of groups, but this method is quite different in nature. So Mimura's method uses geometry of the space in a very weak way, and so that's basically why there is no problem with P. So Novak's proof does use the geometry of the space, and so that proof cannot possibly work for all P. So basically, for these groups, he manages to prove the result for P from 2 to 2 plus epsilon with explicit epsilon. That's a nice thing. Well, I mean, how explicit is, I mean, what I mean by explicit, that really depends on how your group is defined. But for example, if I give you an explicit presentation in principle, you can compute epsilon. Unfortunately, In all examples where it has been applied so far, epsilon is not very, very big, so I don't think there is any single example, for example, with epsilon greater than 1. But anyway, it's an interesting method that gives lots of examples. Okay, and
I have some cases where they say that FNP implies FAQ or Q less than P.
I don't think so. I don't think so. You just know that you have it. Yeah, so but yeah, so you mean for some specific classes of
abstractly, like the
I don't think so. Okay, and so the the last method that I want to mention, and this is what the method I'm going to discuss in this talk, is the so-called what I called almost orthogonality method. So this method was introduced in a paper by Demar and Yanushkevich in 2002. Then it was kind of rephrased and generalized in, okay, Demar and Yanushkevich, I'll refer as DJ from now on, was generalized in our paper with Andrei Haikin, and then further generalized by Martin Kasabov in 2011. So for the rest of the talk, I'll first tell you roughly what this method is for property T, then I will discuss generalization to FLP, and then in the end, I'll briefly mention what kind of explicit results it gives and can potentially give. Okay, so first of all, what is almost orthogonality? So it's actually a very simple definition, the definition due to Demar and Yanushkevich. So let G be a group, H and K subgroups of G. And let's assume that they generate G. And so let us define the orthogonality constant between H and K. And so here is what we're going to do. So let us take any unitary representation of G without global invariant vectors. Let us take vector u, which is invariant under the first subgroup, h, and the vector w, which is invariant under the second subgroup, k. And let us look at the product uw and normalize, right? So geometrically, of course, this is just the cosine of the angle between those two vectors, and then they take the supremum over all such triples. So that's the orthogonality constant, so it's some number between 0 and 1. And a very simple but actually very useful observation, which was made in a paper of Demar and Yanushkevich, is that if orthogonality constant between some two subgroups H and K is less than 1, and both H and K have T, then actually the subgroup generated by H and K has T. This is basically an easy exercise which you can do directly from the definition of property T that I gave you. By itself you cannot really apply this, but this is very useful if you combine it with other things. Okay, so now let me state a criterion which you actually can apply to get lots of examples. So this theorem really went through three stages. So the original form was obtained in the version in the paper of Demar and Dinushkevich. Then we generalized it quantitatively in our paper with Andre, and then it was further generalized by Kasabov. I'm going to state the version from our paper just as well, because it's actually maybe the simplest to state and also most suitable for this talk. So suppose now that a group G is generated by n subgroups, such that first each of those subgroups has T, and two orthogonality constant between Hi and Hj is less than 1 over n minus 1. So for any I and j. And so then the claim is that the big group has property t. So if n is equal to 2, then we get precisely this. But to get interesting applications, you need to start with n equal to 3. And so roughly speaking, how do you construct example where this is applicable? Well, so the easiest thing is to look at the cases where each hi is finite, and this is automatic. And also, you want subgroup generated by any two of those guys to be small, and you want to have a good understanding of representation theory of that group. In that case, you can just basically classification of representations allows you to compute orthogonality. Yeah, so the nice thing is that you really need to understand your group locally. Like, the group can be huge, but kind of if all two generated subgroups are simple, have simple structure, then you can check these conditions. Okay, so now what about the, let me just tell you in two words how you prove this. So the simplest proof of this result is due to Kasabov, and the proof is by induction on n. Okay, and so how does the proof go? So you start with n subgroups which generate G, and then you replace n subgroups by n minus 1 subgroups which still generate G, such that the orthogonality constant between the new collection of subgroups, well, they're not as good as the original ones, but they don't go up by much. Right, and so then you go from n subgroups to n minus 1 subgroups, then from n minus 1 to n minus 2, and each time orthogonality constant goes up by just a little bit, and then at some point, you are left with two subgroups, which still generate your group. If at that point, the orthogonality constant is still less than 1, you just apply this observation, and you're done. Okay, so now let me first formulate. So that's the main theorem for this talk. And that's the analog of this theorem for property FLP. So actually, the setup is very similar. So we have G generated by n subgroups H1 through Hn, such that, well, the first condition, well, it's an analog of this one, but you need to assume a little bit more. So there exists a K greater than or equal to, well, actually, let me fix K. Yeah, and fix K, which is at least 2. And so the first assumption I want to make is that the subgroup generated by hi1 through hik has FLP. So subgroup generated by any k of my subgroups has FLP. So k has to be at least 2. And the second condition is that the orthogonality constant between any two of these subgroups is less than, let's say, delta for some delta. Okay, and so then what's the conclusion? So then there exists a constant M, which depends on these three things, n, k, and delta. Such and this constant is greater than 2 such that G has FLP for all, and this is explicitly computable. I could write a formula, but it's a bit messy, so I prefer not to do that. For FLP for all p in the interval from 2 to this m. Okay. It's still Hilbert space orthogonality. Yeah. Okay. I will mention the LPO analog. Yeah. But the nice thing is that, this condition only, it's verifiable in terms of unitary representations of this. Well, delta has to be. Actually, let me think. No. So actually, sorry. Yeah. If delta has to be sufficiently small, and I don't want to make this precise. Yeah. So then, if delta is sufficiently small. Yeah. You're right. I mean, definitely has to be less than 1, but also this is not good enough. Again, you can make this explicit, but it's the general condition is a bit messy.
But for 1, you assume FNP for some.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah. So the condition is that if you want to prove FLP for some p.
So you fix p.
Okay. Let me reformulate it in.
When it's quantified, this FLP. What is p?
This.
The first line. It's any p or some p.
It's the same. It's the same p.
For p is for all p.
No. Okay. For some p. So.
It's all written down. So for some p.
Which is the same question as the conclusion. Like, so if you want to say that it is an M and P delta, so that if all the subgroups have FLP, then.
Yeah, but you know it is less.
Yes, maybe you want to move one into.
Okay, yeah, I'm sorry. So. Okay. Let me do it like that. Okay, sorry. So let's just assume that the orthogonality constant between hi and hj is less than delta for all I not equal to j for some delta. Okay, so then if delta is sufficiently small, there exists m greater than 2 such that g will have FLP for all p from 2 to m, such that, and let me put, such that also, the subgroup generated by any k of those guys has FLP. Okay, I'm sorry, this looks a little bit technical. This is not really a problem in all practical applications, because in all practical applications, those groups will usually be finite. Or you will know that they have FLP for all p. So this doesn't really give you any restrictions. Okay, but one thing I want to mention about this constant m is that what happens to it if delta goes to 0? Okay, and so I don't really, okay, let me, I'm sorry about not putting maybe at the optimal place. So moreover, what happens if we fix n and k, and we look at the limit as delta goes to 0, m of n k delta, then this limit is going to be equal to actually infinity if k is at least 3, and it's going to be equal to some strange number 2 over log to the base 2 of 4 thirds, which is approximately 4.82 if k is equal to 2. Yeah. So if k is so the nice thing about this criterion is that if k is at least 3 and if delta is really, really small, then you get an FLP over large and larger intervals. For k equal to 2, unfortunately, you cannot go beyond this number. Okay, so.
So do you mean you have some examples of groups for which FL2 over log 4/3 is not satisfied?
No. I mean, these are only positive results. I have no idea. No. I mean, most likely this is the failure of the method. No. I cannot prove any negative results by this method.
What are new examples you get of groups specifically?
I want to talk about roughly about the proof, and then I'll mention examples in the end. Is that okay? Okay. So now, how much time do I have left? Is there an official
word?
7 minutes. Can we make it 8?
Yes.
Okay. So let me briefly mention the idea of the proof, very briefly. First of all, let me put this back. One difficulty in extending the approach for this proof to FLP setting is that there is no analog of this result for property FLP, at least we don't have one. So you can imitate the induction proof, but the proof would have to end differently. You cannot end it with two subgroups. Actually, you have to end it with three subgroups. And so here is a sketch of the proof. And let me do it in the case when n equal to 3 and k equal to 2. So here is our setup. So g is generated by three subgroups. And for subgroups generated by any two of those guys, we do have FLP. So take an affine isometric action. Let's call it alpha of G on some Banach space, on some LP, which I'll denote by B. So now since subgroup generated by any two of those guys has FLP, I will have fixed points for those subgroups. And the set of fixed if I have any fixed point, the set of fixed points forms a hyperplane. Just a fine subspace. So I have three subspaces. So this is B fixed by H1, H2. This is B fixed by H1, H3. And this is B fixed by H2, H3, right? What I want to show is that these three subspaces intersect. And so then I have a global fixed point. Actually, it's enough to show that any two of them intersect. Okay, and the way to do it is that you look at all triangles where vertices lie in the respective subspaces. And the first claim is that, so step one is that there exists a triangle of minimal perimeter. Whose vertices lie in the respective subspaces. Okay, and this is a very elementary proof, uses very little information about it. The only thing we need to know about B at this point is that it is uniformly convex, and some mild assumptions about the group. So then you show that the vertices of that, now take a triangle of minimal perimeter. I show that the vertices of that triangle satisfy certain algebraic equations. I'm not going to write them formally, but geometrically, roughly those equations mean that the sides of the triangle are orthogonal to respective hyperplanes. So now we're in a Banach space, so there is no orthogonality in the classical sense, but there is kind of a natural analog of that. And then you show that step two, show that use those algebraic equations to show that the minimal perimeter is zero. And therefore, this triangle is actually a point, which is what we want, if LP orthogonality constants. So that's what I was asked about, are small enough. Okay, and now the what remains to do is to relate. Okay, LP orthogonality constants, I'm not defining them, but they define by taking my definition of Hilbert spaces and finding a suitable analog. So there is no inner product, but there is some way to define it. And so the last thing to do is to relate those guys to the usual orthogonality constants, which I have in my statement. And that's actually, there is a general theorem, which is also proved in our paper, is that for any subgroups H and K, the LP orthogonality constant between those two subgroups, actually there is a explicit bound in terms of L2 orthogonality constant, so it is L2 orthogonality constant, the usual orthogonality constant to the power 2 over P times 2 to the power 1 minus 2 over P. And that's actually an analytic proof which uses the so-called Stein interpolation theory. Okay, and I guess I have maybe 2 minutes left, and so now I can briefly. Okay, so yeah, I'm looking for something to erase. I want to keep the criterion for property FLP. Let me erase the property T version. So what are the examples where this method is applicable? The first class of examples will be two spherical applications. So these are all applications to FLP. So these are the groups where you can prove FLP by this method. So two spherical Katz-Moody groups over sufficiently large finite fields. So if you're not familiar with Katz-Moody groups, you can think of this as kind of suitable analogs of arithmetic groups in positive characteristics. Kind of there. Like guys like this one. But they're larger, they're more complicated. Okay, and this is actually a special case, and we didn't do that yet in this paper, but I think you can prove a more general criterion for certain groups acting on buildings. So the property T version of this criterion, actually a certain generalization of it, was used in our paper with Andre to prove property T for E, L, and R. So for in the case of this P has nothing to do with this F finite field. In the case of property FLP, you can get weaker result, but because Mimura already proved everything in full generality, starting with for E, L, N, starting with N equal to 4, it only makes sense to talk about what happens for P equal to 3 and for N equal to 3. And so what we can prove is that you have property property FLP for EL3R, where R is an algebra, is a finitely generated algebra over a sufficiently large finite field. Unfortunately, to get the proof for EL3i, you need to apply this criterion for k equal to 2, so you cannot go beyond this p. And finally, the last class of examples, let me just briefly mention that you can construct lots of. So in general, you can use this method to construct groups by generator centralization, and particularly you can find some Golodchev-Arevich groups satisfying FLP. Okay, and I think I'm out of time, so I'll stop here.
Thank you very much. Some questions or remarks?
I have one question. Because yes, the property T is the like, fixed point property is stable under alpha limit, so it's nothing to do with linearity of the LP, right? It's can would be true. This Margulis type theorem for any space which in certain sense flows to the vector and leading to the form convex. The question is if what we prove requires linear, how much it requires linearity and how much uniform convexity.
Linearity of
space LP.
Of space
for perturbation doesn't need linearity.
I think it's used in the. I mean, we
perturbation of course is the same. I mean, it's in the
I think it requires an essential way, but
linearity. You know, which some of the results, some of the problems.
Well, I mean, both linearity and uniform convexity.
No, but some don't require linearity. It's like stability of a property T don't require linearity. It's true for fixed point properties, yes, you never mention linearity. It says all these limits, alpha limit, they don't depend on linearity. And many
you
haven't defined convexity properly, of course, right? Of course, you have to say convexity correctly, if you say it incorrectly, but if you have correct convexity, who cares? For example, have looked at symmetric spaces. There enough convexity.
Well, we're using dual space in an essential way, so I'm not sure how you would handle that. We're using the dual space in an essential way.
You need dual. By the way, then another question: how much you need LP, or it will be true some of that for all sufficiently like super reflexive spaces?
At the moment, I would have no idea how to handle orthogonality constants beyond LP. If you can manage to control orthogonality constants, then I think there is a chance. But
and perhaps secondly is a remark that there was after Kazhdan there were a few kind of fundamental papers on property T, and one of them is due to Mock, which of course never mentioned because he didn't mention property T, but he proved the most kind of basic results on but cohomology of them showing actually to induce and non-induce cohomology of the same. And this is not just his theorem, it was just sublemma. It proved really deep theorem of complex analysis. And there's buried inside of that, it's really, really deep theorem. And you have mentioned about property T, yeah? Mm-hmm. But inside of something, and the what reason is unknown. But it's from, on the other hand, what he does may have relevance to what you do, because he mm-hmm. It's really kind of basic paper, which is never mentioned. You know, you say, if you know it,
no.
You don't know it. It's okay. A basic paper, and everybody should know it. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Other questions or advice?
Yes. How can you estimate the orthogonality constant in some countries?
Oh yeah. I would have said that if I had. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. So in pretty much all of in most of those examples, actually, orthogonality constants comes from a very easy calculation. So you look at you take F a finite field. And look at the Heisenberg group over F, right? So these are just 3x3 upper unit triangular matrices, and so the let's call this maybe A, and the subgroups B and C of A would be just the subgroup, the root subgroups. So the first one matrices which only have something non-zero in 1, 2 position, and the second one would be this one. Okay, and so for those subgroups, you can just representation theory of this group is very simple. So and you can compute orthogonality constant. Okay, in this case B and C, it is 1 over square root of the size of the field, right? And so if the size of the field goes to infinity, delta goes to zero. And so that's okay, and that allows you to find families actually here and here where this constant m of the criterion goes to infinity. You can do the same thing by taking two parabolic subgroups in SL3. But the idea is that in this criterion you want those groups to be small because if the group is big enough I mean if Yeah. So you want to have a very good understanding of representation theory to compute this course.
Just a remark. You said that EL2 have nothing to do with probability, but that's true in the commutative setting. But you can have the EL2 with probability in for lattices in quaternions, or I mean, it comes quite quickly.
EL2 over what would be the ring?
The ring is a co-compact subring of the quaternions.
You're saying that it has property T?
Yeah, but that's because it's a lattice in a...
Oh, okay. Sorry. I didn't know about that. Sorry.
Yes. So what about so you have some application to uniformly bilix the phi action cube space on your...
None that I know of, but I didn't think about it.
It's very related to automatic. Yeah.
You mentioned that you can do buildings, but do you need some like really buildings coming from Katz-Moody groups?
It needs to be too spherical, and there are some some conditions which, I'm not an expert on buildings. So if you give me a specific building, I...
Okay, last question, maybe.
What are the Golodchev-Rayovich examples?
Well, Golodchev-Rayovich examples, essentially all examples come from... Okay, so basically you can do it for any group. So you can start with a group generated with generators x1 through xd, some relations, and then you would add relations of the following form. Each generator to some large power, let's say q equal to 1, and then commutate of xi with xj and 1 more time with xj equal to 1. These two relations would ensure that any two generators generate a quotient of Heisenberg group. And therefore, you can handle large orthogonality also. So as long as you can prove that this group is still infinite, you get an interesting example. So for Golodchev-Rayovich groups, you can get lots of examples where this would still be Golodchev-Rayovich and therefore infinite.
OK, well, let's thank the speaker. And